Hey everybody, Nathan Foulkes here. So I'd like to put my teacher's hat on for a few minutes with you, if you don't mind, because many of you who have been coming to me with your portfolios for me to take a look at how they're coming along with your high hopes of becoming a really great concept artist, I've been noticing that more and more, many of you have been going down what I consider to be a blind alley. So let me show you what I mean here, and then I have for you some very simple solutions for designing with color and light that I think can create some real opportunities for you in your concept art portfolio. So here's an in-progress production frame from a show that I worked on a couple of years ago. It was a lot of fun. It was a show I was invited by Disney to color script, do the lighting and color design. It was myself and a really great artist named Fred Warder, and we put this thing together. It was a prequel for the Peter Pan story. It was the story of how Captain Hook became Captain Hook. And so here's a scene that came back just way too neutral. This is in fact part of a musical number. It was meant to have a real vibrance, for the colors to play beautifully with the lively music, and it just came back dead and neutral. Well, it's my job to fix that. So let's take this into Photoshop and let me show you something here. So let's do this. I said this scene needed a strong pop of color, so let's try this. Let's just go in the channel palette. We'll select the red palette, and then we'll turn the RGB back on, but the red palette selected. And then we'll just go in here, and we'll just take that, and we'll just separate that channel out a little bit here. And of course that makes the scene blurry, so we can just go back in and go in the history brush here and just paint the details back in wherever we need them. And ta-da, we have a vibrant pop of color. Except that if I actually did that over at Disney, if I presented this as a viable solution to bring more color into the scene, they would laugh me out of the studio. And if they thought I was actually serious, they would lift me out of my office, stuff me into one of those nondescript Disney vans, and drive me out to the Mojave Desert, you know, the one where all the bodies are buried, and beat me. That's the response I would get if I considered this to be a color solution. And yet, I am seeing portfolio after portfolio that somehow seems to believe that this is a viable solution for bringing a pop of color vibrance into our images. Now don't get me wrong, this is art. Art means you can do anything that you want to do. And there's no solution that is always bad or wrong. As a matter of fact, to the best of my understanding, where this all started was I remember seeing a group of really great concept artists who did stylized graphic sci-fi scenes that were meant to have a nice techno vibe. And so what they would do is they were creating their graphic effect. At the end, they would do a channel separation just like this. And what it did was, it made it look like you weren't looking at the scene itself, but you were looking at a video screen showing the scene. And so it gave this additional layer of techno vibe onto the scene. And it was kind of fun. And I thought it worked. And because it worked, other people picked it up, nothing wrong with that. But then somehow, it spread beyond those borders into some kind of a legitimate color solution for any and every kind of scene. And maybe this is where my true colors come out as some kind of pompous know-it-all. But you know how when you become overexposed to something, sometimes you can develop an allergy to it? This is in so many portfolios that are being brought to me that I used to just think, oh, it's disappointing to see a color solution that just can't go anywhere. But now I'm actually getting that allergic reaction. I mean, I see it and I'm getting to the point where I just cringe. My hands start to shake. My skin starts to crawl. I get bleeding from the eyes. All right, enough with the theatrics. I'm sure I've way overmade my point. But I am very serious when I call this a blind alley. So allow me to throw out a few pointers that can turn us around and put us on a path that really opens up opportunities for a great range of mood, emotion, and storytelling for your concept art portfolio. Let me jump back and show you the actual solution for this scene and many other scenes like it, and we'll go through point by point. Okay, so here's the actual solution for the scene right here. Washed out version that needed some life and some light and some vibrance. And so here's the scene. And this scene is attempting to understand better how light would bring a vibrant luminosity to the scene, how the light would interact with materials, how local colors, the colors of individual objects, can play against each other in a visually interesting way, the way that light bounces around in an environment, and the way the color of the light itself can be utilized. And so those are exactly the points that we're going to go through here, step by step. First one, create a variety of local colors. So let's jump to the animated movie Sinbad, Legend of the Seven Seas. So we had a lot of fun with the color design in this show that was headed up by Ramon Zeebach, who became the production designer of the Kung Fu Panda movies. And I had the opportunity to paint and design the color keys for several sequences of the film and do some concept art that we had a good time with. And so let's start simple here with our ideas about local color, because this is an environment that's largely neutral. Now, I know there's a lot of color here, but we have kind of warm gray rocks, we have ocean water, and we have gray clouds. Lots of neutral local colors. Local color, again, being the color of individual objects. And so the color in the environment comes from light, warm light and cool light. More on that later. But for now, one of our ideas was we would have environments like this that relied on rich, warm and cool subtleties of lighting. And then we would find an opportunity to do a vibrant pop of color through local color, finding a powerful local color accent, just like this. The boat here having the rich local colors of orange, red oranges, and then a little bit of green there on the boat is a nice complement to that. And so that's bringing a strong vibrance of local color to our scene. Let's now jump to The Road to El Dorado, because this was a movie that wasn't just relying on individual pops of local color accents. This was a show that often had local colors everywhere. And so here's one of my paintings for the show, and it was frankly a hard painting to do. One of the reasons it was so hard is that we've got to develop an understanding of how does light interact with local colors of objects. Here we have neutral stone, we have green foliage, we have gold, shimmering gold, we have buildings and stonework that's painted a variety of colors, as well as colorful rugs, pottery, etc. And so the vibrance and excitement of scenes like these comes out of the design of the individual local colors. So it is hard to do, but it's something we must get comfortable doing. Many of the portfolios I look at avoid this. And how much confidence are the studios and the game houses going to put in someone who avoids one of the best color solutions because it's hard? So our next idea is to emphasize warm bounce lights and cool atmospheric lights. And so what I want to do is take a look at a scene that I did for Sinbad, Legend of the Seven Seas. So in this scene, I was targeting rich qualities of warms and cools, just like the reds and the cyan colors we got when we did that channel separation. I'm frankly going for the same kind of warm, cool vibrance in this scene. But what I'm trying my best to do is to use how light and local color really work so that we can believe in the solution. So this is actually a crop in. It was a big panorama. Here's the whole thing. And it relied on warm, neutral local colors. All this rock work was a warm rock, nice warm greens in the foliage. And then the qualities of sunset light coming through, hitting surfaces, bouncing around. But then as a powerful complementary element, we have the blue sky up above and to the opposite side of the sky from the warm sunset. All of that blue light shines into the shadows and gives a shimmering contrast to all of those local color warms and the warm quality of the sunset light. So let's take this one into Photoshop and take a closer look. Okay, here we go. So let's zoom in. You saw a close-up, you got kind of the gist of what's happening here, but the underlying color, and this is all painted in Photoshop. In fact, this was one of my very early Photoshop paintings. This was right at the time when we made the transition from traditional painting in acrylics for our painted scenes in animated movies. We made that transition to digital painting, primarily done in Photoshop. So this is a Photoshop painting. And so we have the warm local colors of the rock peeking through these darks in the crevices, but then we have the cool light coming into the shadows. I'll just pull out a little bit so you can see how the things contrast with each other. And of course, the sunlight hitting surfaces cast shadows, and then that warm light is going to bounce into adjacent shadows. For instance, this side plane right here is catching a nice warm bounce from this light, and so that gives us an additional level of vibrance. These warm bounce lights in the shadows, complemented by the cool atmospheric skylight in the shadow, plus the warm underlying local color, gets a lot of richness, my friends. We can get so much richness and just get a shimmering jewel-like quality out of that. Next step, break single colors into hue variations. And so for this, I want to jump to the animated movie that we did at DreamWorks, Shark Tale. So here's an example, a piece of concept art that I did for the show. And you can see once again how we're targeting a rich variety of color here. That color pop. Another example, kind of a character piece in the environment. And let's jump from there to a comp. I want to take you through these quick roughs and show you a very simple solution to keep a richness of color even in scenes that are very neutral. So let's bring this into Photoshop and take a look. So it's a moment where the main character is being chased by a shark. The shark gets trapped. And then while he's trapped, he's attacked by shrimp, of all things. So like I say, these are loose. But you can see that even though these are gray local colors with gray lighting overall, that targeted richness of color is a priority. So it's really a simple thing to do. You start with your base color, whatever it happens to be. Maybe it's that. In this particular case, it is. And then you just go to your color selector. I like to use a magic picker, which is an add-on. You have to buy it and add it onto Photoshop, but it's cheap. And I'll just do maybe a warmer and a cooler version of this color is a very simple way to think of it. So it's kind of a neutral greenish color. And so let's go up to the purples. I think that's about right. So we can take, and we can just kind of sprinkle in a variety of those colors. And then we can do a warmer version of the color. We'll come down into the yellow greens. Okay, so you can take a neutral color and give it a rich vibrance by approaching it like that. Now, we do need to never lose the logic of the light. That's where we often go wrong when we're designing our color, is kind of drifting away from the logic of what the light would really do. And so remember, there's kind of a cool gray light coming onto everything. And that's why I have a color like this one additionally. And so we kind of throw that color on as well. And that brings the local color and the quality of light into balance. All right, and it's really just that simple. And our final concept, to bring richness and vibrance to our concept artwork using colored light sources. Now I do this one last because what we've just covered is kind of like baking a great cake and then splashing some colored dynamic light sources onto our scenes. It's kind of like putting the frosting on the cake. You got to be able to bake a really great cake before you frosting it. That's why this one is last. So let's jump to some concept artwork I did for The Legend of Puss in Boots. Here's a scene that, like some of our previous challenges, has a lot of neutral local colors. A lot of neutral clothing, neutral brickwork. And so in this case, we bring it to life with warm and cool light sources. We have the cool of the moonlight streaming in. I've exaggerated and emphasized it intentionally. And then we have the complementing warmth of candlelight, torchlight, and lanterns to set the warms and cools against each other. And I have to say that even though this was a fairly complex scene to do, I admit it, this was a tough scene for me to work out. And the only way I had any shot of pulling it together was to keep those simple, warm, cool relationships working together. So the scene is actually very simple in its underlying structure of light and shadow, and its underlying structure of warm and cool. And one last bit, because we started out by talking about the Disney project, the backstory of Captain Hook and the Pirates, and so when we needed theatrical moments, we did exactly that. Rich, vibrant pops of colored lights, especially as rim lighting, so that it gives us good strong contrasts and good strong silhouettes of the characters. Okay, so those are our four simple concepts to help us break out of that low ceiling that we sometimes set for ourselves when we rely on tricks of the digital tools rather than solid principles. It's the difference between cheap rhinestones and diamonds. Our concept art really can be gems that will sparkle if we learn how to polish them right. So my absolutely fantastic hosts for tutorials like these and online art classes at schoolism.com, that's where you'll find my Designing with Color and Light course, as well as my course on environment design, and my course on pictorial compositions, where we have fully critiqued classes or self-taught subscriptions for as low as $15 a month. So I want to wish you good luck with your work. You're gonna do fantastic. I'm looking forward to all of the great artwork to come.